There's a lot of unknowns, and I think it's the unknowns that are terrifying.
And it's me. It's me on that operating table.
We're developing the bio-artificial pancreas that can potentially cure type 1 diabetes.
It's become a joke that the cure is always 5 years away. But if it's so close, what is taking so long?
Yeah, why is the cure to type 1 diabetes taking so long? And will the pain, the worry, the burdens of this deadly disease strike you or someone you love before that cure comes? More than 1.5 million Americans live with type 1 diabetes, known once as juvenile diabetes because it often strikes during childhood, as it did with my son Ben. Our lives as a family and the lives of every person and family diagnosed with T1D suddenly and permanently upended through no fault of their own, because this disease cannot be prevented. In short, it can happen to you. A diagnosis means a lifetime of blood sugar checks, insulin injections, debilitating blood sugar highs and lows, and worry that this deadly disease might claim the life of your child or an adult with type 1 diabetes. But there is hope, and a world of researchers working and making progress toward cures. A new film is documenting one promising path to one of those cures. It tells the story of the startup behind it and the patients who have volunteered to sacrifice their physical and mental health to help others with type 1 diabetes. It's called The Human Trial, and it's an unprecedented look at the science of medicine and the people who make it happen. This is very personal to me and to my guest today, the director and producer of The Human Trial, a person who is living with type 1 diabetes herself, Lisa Hepner. Lisa, thank you for joining us. Thank you for this film. I know that it's years in the making. Congratulations.
Thank you so much, Frank, and thank you so much for having me on your show today.
Of course.
I know you're intimately familiar with living with type 1, and yeah, like you say, it's not an easy disease.
No, it certainly is not. Many of us in the type 1 community have been waiting to see your film. And before we get into what you found during the filming, what was your mission with this film, and why did you decide to take this on?
Well, you know, it started off as me wanting to figure out why we didn't have a cure when most of us with type 1 diabetes have been promised since our diagnosis that the cure was 5 years away. Mm-hmm. And so I, being a patient with type 1 diabetes, but also being a documentarian as well as my husband, we were increasingly motivated to find out why we were still waiting every 5 years for this breakthrough. And we did a lot of research, and we talked to a lot of different research teams before we settled on filming with ViaCyte in San Diego. Mm.
Before we get too far down the road, I want to back up, because I think a lot of people have heard diabetes. They assume type 2 diabetes and what we associate with that. They may or may not know the difference between type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes. And I wonder if you can just sort of quickly explain what your daily life is like when you have type 1 diabetes and how that's different from type 2 diabetes.
Sure. So type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disorder where my body unfortunately destroyed my insulin-producing cells. This means that I have to be on insulin injections for the rest of my life until there is a cure. And that it means that I have to think like a pancreas, something I was never trained to do. Type 2 diabetes is a situation where the person's body doesn't absorb insulin effectively. It can be treated through exercise, losing weight, and often insulin injections as well. So, you know, I don't look at type 1 and type 2 as that different, because the long-term complications are the same.
You talked about having to think like a pancreas when you have type 1 diabetes. What does that mean?
It means that I have to regulate my blood sugar every minute of the day. And I don't think people really understand how much proper glucose levels affect how you function. So everything affects my diabetes. And I have to, I don't inject insulin. I'm on an insulin pump that's attached to me that I replace every 3 days. And I wear a continuous glucose monitor that gives me readings, blood sugar readings every 2 minutes. But it doesn't replace what a normal person's pancreas does automatically. I have to think constantly about my diabetes. In fact, I make 180 different decisions per day because of this disease. If I walk up the stairs, I have to think, you know, am I going to go low because I didn't, you know, calibrate properly for this exercise? I mean, Frank, even right now, as I talk to you, I think to myself, am I in a good place?
With that as a backdrop, and the idea that more than 1.5 million Americans are living with this same 24/7 burden, including my son, Ben, many of us who are in the type 1 community, and I fundraise through JDRF, to help fund research. And one of the recipients is ViaCyte. And I remember years ago hearing about this startup in San Diego County. Tell us about it. Tell us what you heard about it. And tell us why you wanted to focus on what they were doing.
So ViaCyte has been working on a cure since 2004. And they found the stem cell line that they have programmed to replace our cells in 2005. I was really intrigued because, frankly, I believe that stem cells are the future for a myriad of diseases to either treat or cure. So when I learned that ViaCyte was programming a stem cell line to become islet cells that would then be implanted in a patient's body and mature over time to release insulin and think like an islet cell, I was pretty excited to learn more.
And just so people understand, we're talking about a functional cure. This is not something that is going to cure someone of having the disease, but it is going to relieve them of that daily burden of 180 decisions a day.
That is true. However, I look at it as a cure. If I don't have to think about my disease mm-hmm. and think about the long-term complications that include amputation, blindness, kidney disease, strokes, I look at that as a cure.
Yeah. And the people who are participating in this clinical research, they are, as I said earlier, sacrificing themselves. And you focus on a couple of these incredible people. One of them is a man named Greg Romero, who is suffering from depression throughout this. And that's part of this, is the emotional and mental strain that everyone goes through who either has type 1 diabetes or is a caregiver or a family member of such a person. I want to run a clip of him and what he has to say, and then I'll talk to you about it on the other side.
What? Oh. Come on, lady, let's go find a pumpkin.
We're talking about my life here. And I, you know, I'm not afraid of death, but I'm here. I need to be here for my daughter. That's what this is about.
Well, come here.
Come in.
Want to see pumpkin?
Quick, there.
And it's not just because she's going to be in this world alone. So I want to see her grow up. I don't want to abandon her. That's the worst feeling on earth.
Talk to us about that, your relationship that you developed with Mr. Romero and what you learned about his life.
I think Greg is an extraordinary human being. He grew up in St. Paul, Minnesota, without financial support, without emotional support, and without family support. And the fact that he was diagnosed at 11 and he's now my age, early 50s, and the fact that he doesn't have, the fact that he's still here is a testament to his will to survive. And I was blown away by Greg. and Maren for that matter, the other patient in the trial, I grew very close to the patients we profiled. Not only did, you know, obviously I'm empathetic, I have the disease, but I saw what they were going through in this clinical trial and what they were sacrificing for us and for your son.
Yeah.
And it took so much strength, but they did it.
And it's interesting because when I heard about this trial and I thought about the patients who were involved, I thought, oh, how lucky for them. Because it seemed so promising and it seemed like, wow, they're gonna get a break from the daily burdens of type one. But you really reveal in your film that it's not like that.
So ViaCyte programmed these stem cells and put them into a credit card-like device that was then implanted into the patient. This meant that they had to go into surgery to get these devices implanted. And then this also meant they had to go back into surgery to get them explanted, which means removed, so the researchers could see how the cells were surviving. This was a lot. It was a lot of pressure. It was a lot of stress. But I can say at the same time, there was such a commitment by the patients to help.
Yeah. They're remarkable human beings. And when people watch this film, The Human Trial, they will see that. We're going to take a short break. We'll be back with Lisa Hepner, the filmmaker who made The Human Trial, when we come back.
We still don't know how it'll work in people. And that's why we're all here, to make it work in people.
32 years of the waiting, hoped and prayed for this for a long time.
And welcome back to Frank Buckley Interviews. That was from the new documentary, The Human Trial. I want to get back to our conversation with its director, Lisa Hepner. Lisa, that clip we showed some of the scientists who work at ViaCyte. You mentioned repeatedly that you occupied this odd space as the filmmaker, being between the ViaCyte researchers and the patients, and you had some concerns about potentially altering the study just by documenting it. How did you work around that?
It was an extraordinary place to be because we became the bridge between the patient's experience and what the researchers were doing in their lab. And the FDA mandates that there be no interaction between the sponsor of a study, which in this case was ViaCyte, and the patients. And this is because they don't want the trial, or the patients rather, to be influenced by the sponsor. So it keeps the integrity of the study. But for us as filmmakers, we were given this incredibly privileged glimpse behind the scenes. So when Greg and Maren were thinking that the cells were working, I knew from ViaCyte that they weren't. And there were points in the film where I felt really badly for the patients. And here I am filming, you know, them being told in the last scene that it didn't work. And I thought to myself, well, of course I can't prepare them because I need to be a verite filmmaker. Mm-hmm. There were many times when I just wanted to give them a hug and say, it's going to be okay. But it wasn't my place to do so. I needed to protect the sanctity of that clinical trial.
Yeah.
And it that weighed heavily on all of us. But, you know, as journalists, and I'm sure you know this too, you have to respect the rules of the game.
Absolutely, because you don't want to jeopardize the research in any way in this case. I do want to talk about some of the people involved on the research side of this, because that's the other part of this story that you were able to tell, to show us the people who are involved in the actual research, the executives who are trying to keep the money flowing to fund this research. And there's a moment, a very powerful moment in this film, when you talk to one of the executives who is trying to raise this money, who's trying to tell you to keep the faith. And I want to share that right now with our viewers.
Do you feel guilty that the cure is always 5 years away?
I don't feel guilty. I feel hopeful. I feel really hopeful. I'm not kidding.
You do?
Yes.
Like, really? For
real? That's so nice of you.
I'm working here. I can see what's going on. It's... It's gonna be good for you. I know it's been really hard as heck. I mean. I'm not kidding. It's true. I mean, there's nobody, no person with a Dexcom or a pump or anything works as well as the cells.
And we're talking about the cells, the beta cells in the pancreas, and the cells that they're putting into these capsules that they're putting into the body, that there's so much hope on this. And as you said, the first two patients, it didn't appear to work. That raw moment that you experienced, did that surprise you?
You know, it did. Eugene Brandon, who is the ViaCyte executive I'm speaking to, was very sympathetic to the patients in the trial. And in fact, I would say most of the people at ViaCyte understood what it means to live with type 1 diabetes. And if they didn't understand it, they certainly did after hanging out with me for 7 years. And so, you know, they rode the roller coaster with me too, with my own diabetes and seeing the complications that I was experiencing. So I think you see in that clip that Eugene genuinely cares. And I knew that he cared, but I didn't think he would show that emotion. You know, you don't normally get that from scientists.
I don't want to leave it with people that two of these patients that you profiled that didn't work, as you said, that was the end result of the study. Where is the study now, and what is your hope level based on what you saw in the study?
I'm very hopeful. And I'm a jaded journalist and a jaded patient. And I really am hopeful, probably for the first time in my life. I think that we can get to a cure for this disease, functional cure, within the next 5 years.
Now, hold on a second, Lisa. Hold on a second. You know that phrase kills me and everyone else. For you to say in 5 years, that must mean something.
Yes. No, absolutely. And I must give this caveat that we will get there in 5 years if we fund this research properly, if we collaborate, mandate collaboration the way we did when we got shots in arms for the COVID vaccine. We saw what was possible. We saw that within 6 months, this promising technology was injected, turned into a vaccine and injected into arms, and it worked. That was 6 months. So imagine if we already have the science, we know it's working. We know it's working in patients. ViaCyte has proved efficacy, but keep funding them. Let's look at what we did during the pandemic and learn from those lessons before it's in our rearview mirror. It's not a pipe dream.
That is so wonderful to hear. All right, we're going to take one more short break. We're back with the documentary filmmaker, Lisa Hepner, in just a moment. And welcome back to Frank Buckley Interviews. We're speaking with filmmaker Lisa Hepner. She's the director of the new documentary, The Human Trial. Lisa, I want to ask you about the two people who you profile in this film, Greg and Marin. Where are they today? And if you were to ask them today, was it worth it, your participation, the sacrifices you made for this human clinical trial, was it worth it? What would their answer be?
I think they would say it was worth it. I think they're very honest about how challenging it was for them. But at the end of the day, they believe enough in science and the fact that researchers have to do this kind of invasive study to move the needle on cure research. I think, again, very honestly, they would say, yeah, it was really rough. Mm. The hope, despair roller coaster was real. And, despite the fact they knew that they were early in the study and that they wouldn't really benefit from it, they couldn't help but hope that they would be the exception.
And just to be clear, you continue to hope that while those two patients, one and two, it didn't work at the level that we all hoped it would work, later patients, it is working, isn't it?
Yes. So ViaCyte has shown some good results. And more excitingly, they're working with CRISPR, the gene editing company, to edit their stem cell line so that a body doesn't reject the cells. Now, why is this important? It's important because the patient doesn't need to be put on immunosuppressant drugs.
That is wonderful news, and all of us have followed this CRISPR part of it with great joy, and you've left us with hope, and I want to thank you very much.
Thank you so much for having me.
You bet.
It was a pleasure.
The new documentary, The Human Trial, opens Friday, June 24th in New York and Los Angeles. It's also available to stream and available in theaters, as you can see, around the country. For a full list of those showings, go to the website. It's thehumantrial.com/watch. There's going to be a special screening of The Human Trial Saturday, June 25th at the Lemley Playhouse 7 in Pasadena. You can find out more about that at thehumantrial.com. I'm going to be moderating a Q&A after the screening. Thanks to Lisa Hepner, and thank you for watching. We hope you'll join us on the audio podcast for more of our conversation.